Today I'm going to start by explaining the unit method of construction. You'll find it not only saves you time, but since most of you don't have a day or even a half day for sewing, you'll find that if you have 15 minutes, you can pick up a unit and have the satisfaction of completing that unit in a short length of time. And now, let me show you what I mean by unit construction. Here are the pieces of our dress as we finished cutting and marking them last time. Patterns are still pinned in place, and leave the patterns pinned until you're ready to sew each unit. Each piece of our pattern represents a unit. This is our front blouse unit, and we'll do all the stitching we can on this, such as putting in the darts and the pleats before we join another unit to it. The next unit that will go to that will be the front facing. Then the back blouse. And again, we will complete all we can on this piece before joining it to the front unit. Then the next would be our collar, and we'll complete our collar before attaching it to the blouse. Next, the sleeve. We'll do all the stitching we can on that, then complete our cuff and attach the cuff to the sleeve before joining the sleeve to the blouse. And that would complete our blouse. Next would be the skirt. We'll complete the back skirt. Then we'll complete the front skirt, join the two before we join those pieces to the blouse. Here are our dress units organized, ready for sewing. You'll find it to your advantage to arrange your sewing equipment in a well-lighted place where it'll be convenient for you to use. Just as the U-shaped kitchen has proven efficient, you'll find that the U-shaped arrangement for your sewing equipment will also be efficient. Here on my left is a small cabinet where we will keep extra thread and small equipment that we'll be using while we construct the dress. If you don't have such a cabinet, you could use a chair or a bench to hold your units, for that's another purpose for this cabinet. Then on my right, I've placed the ironing table, since I'm right-handed and can grasp the iron easily when I need it. Now this table was specially made. If you don't have anybody to make a table such as this for you, take an unused end table and pad it, and use it for your ironing table. Or if you don't have a place to keep this kind of a table, you may prefer to use a pad such as this. Just a wide board, well padded and covered. You can put this on a chair or a stool by the side of your sewing machine and use it. Of course, you can use your ordinary ironing board, but it should be an adjustable ironing board so you make it the right height for use at your sewing machine. And then, of course, right in front of you is your sewing machine. I would suggest that you set up such a unit in a convenient place where it can be left open, ready for sewing, such as a guest bedroom, a den, or a utility room, or even the corner of a large kitchen. Just one more thing before we're ready to actually start sewing, and that is to get our machine in good condition. We sometimes forget that lint collects down here around the feed dog and in here around the bobbin. So remove that lint, because those are the two places that lint needs removing most often. And lint plus oil will gum up your machine. Then when you get ready to oil the machine, follow the directions in your direction book and put one drop of oil in each of the holes indicated. Oil it properly, but don't over-oil. And don't use an ordinary household all-purpose oil, but insist on a good sewing machine oil for your machine. And after cleaning and oiling your machine, the next thing to consider is a thread. When sewing on colored fabric, select the regular size thread that will blend with the fabric. And then be sure that you have the same thread on the bobbin that you will have on top. If you're using a white or black thread, remember that they come in many sizes. And the thing for you to remember is to select a size that will be as nearly as possible the same as the threads in the fabric you're sewing on. Next, check your needle to be sure it's sharp by running your finger down over the point of the needle. This needle is sharp, but in case some of you find that yours is dull, you'll need to remove it. And I'll remove this to illustrate a few points. First of all, if you need to buy new needles, compare the length of the new needle with the one you've taken from your machine to be sure it is the right length for your machine, because different machines require different length needles. Then next, check your machine needle for the side that has the groove, by running your fingernail down the groove. And then that side of your needle, or the groove side, goes into your machine on the same side as your last thread guide. Cut the end of your thread with your scissors. Then let the cut end of your thread go right down the groove of the needle until it falls into the eye of the needle. This will save eye strain, for you don't have to get down and look for the eye of the needle. And next, let's be sure your bobbin's wound smoothly. Put the thread from the inside out through one of the holes at the side of the bobbin. And hold on to the end of that thread and put your bobbin on the bobbin winder. Anchor the bobbin in place, loosen the screw on the balance wheel, then hold on to this thread coming from the bobbin, and it will tear itself off as the bobbin winds. I'm not going to finish winding that bobbin at this point, but I think you can see how smoothly it is winding. And by contrast, here is a bobbin that is bunched up on one side and is loosely wound. It's not apt to give you a very good stitch. When you're ready to put the bobbin in the bobbin case, make sure the thread is going around in the right direction, as I'll show you. This is your bobbin case, and this is a slot in the case. Be sure that the thread is going around in this manner so that it will make a U-turn as it goes through the slot. Now, if you picked up your bobbin and the thread was going around in this manner, the thread would just come right straight out of the case and would not stay in place as you started stitching. So this would be wrong. Pick up your bobbin, put it into the case, make sure that the thread is going in the opposite direction so that as it comes back and into the slot, it will make a U-turn and fit right into place. Check the tension on your sewing machine on the double thickness of your dress material. I'm going to use a solid colored fabric so you'll be able to see what I'm doing to the tension. And before we make a row of stitching, we'll need to bring the bobbin thread up to the surface. So I'll hold on to this upper thread and make one stitch. And take hold of the loop and pull it on through and bring both threads back. Then we need to close the plate. Now I'm going to make an extremely tight tension so that you'll be able to see the loops. Lower the presser foot before regulating the tension. Then make a row of stitching. and you can see these loops on the surface. Now let me show you an extremely loose tension. In this case, you see the loops on the lower side of the fabric. Now, you usually won't make this great an adjustment. You should just move the dial a little bit, make a row of stitching, and check your tension, and see if you have any loops either on the top or the lower side of your fabric. After you've regulated the tension so there's no loops on the top or the bottom, make one final check by stitching across a bias. If the threads break on the top and the bottom in the same place when I pull on this, the tension will be correct. Today I've introduced you to unit construction and suggested ways that you can use your sewing equipment more effectively. Believe it or not, next time we're going to start sewing on the first unit of your dress.